कृष्णा कृष्णा हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा हरे हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा रामा हरे
हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा Rama Rama Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna Krishna
Krishna Hare Hare
Hare Rama
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Rama Rama Hare Hare
Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Go, Hare Krishna.
Go, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Anyone else wants to do the kirtan a little bit more? Kids want to do some more?
Okay, we are waiting. Huh?
Then Sheetal Mataji had to sing a song, something.
Sheetal Mataji, thoda unka time idhar ka ja raha hai, lot of hospital activities.
Sure.
Which one you want to sing? The same kirtan in a different tone? Oh, no, Hare Krishna in a different tone.
Or we can do Jai Radha Madhav and then a few rounds of Hare Krishna in that tune.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari
Jai Jana Balama Girivar
Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari
Yashoda Nandana Braj Jan Ranjana
Yamuna Tiravana Chari
Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Yeah, it's you were doing it well. Okay, I will lead if you're okay.
Yes.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare
Krishna,
Krishna Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hari Bol.
Hari Bol. Hare Krishna, everybody. You are having some difficulty with the other technical difficulty with Avni is a hi-fi MacBook.
Okay.
Avni has a MacBook, wow.
So ultimately, my HP oldest standard is helping. Where is Nirbhay Prabhu ji as Adrishya? I
don't know Nirbhay Prabhu kahan pe hai.
Prabhu ji, I'm outside right now. So I just was picking up something and I'll be back soon. So I'll join in a bit.
Okay.
No, you what? Had it on like that. You're the one who only uses it. So you had it like that setting. So you turned it off.
You can take it. Everybody's good.
Everybody's good.
आप अपना माइक को म्यूट रखते हैं भजन में, आपका वहाँ बैकग्राउंड नॉइस रहता है या क्या?
मेरे से पूछ रहे हैं?
हाँ अविनाश पर
हाँ हाँ थोड़ा आवाज रहता है, इसका म्यूट कर देते हैं।
वो लोग को भी बुला लिया करो, भक्त जन को, वो लोग भी भजन करेगा।
सो प्रभु जी, वी वर टॉकिंग कि कोई दो तीन न्यू फैमिलीज आई हैं इन जैक्सन।
हाँ, एक मिले हैं, दूसरा भी आए हैं, वो लोग लगता है होटल में भी 3 महीना रहेंगे।
ओह अच्छा।
अभी एक पहले होता था एक बिहारी 100 पर भारी, अभी 3 बिहारी है, पता नहीं क्या होगा।
जितने ज्यादा उतना बढ़िया। देखिए आपकी एसोसिएशन इतनी बढ़िया है तो फिर और भी बढ़िया ही होगी।
Malena, did you get the joke?
Yeah, I think so.
What did he say? Okay, so today we have to read 15th chapter. We've been talking about it, but Purushottam month we have to read the 15th chapter very, very quickly, just like reading.
Yes.
Is everybody okay with that?
Yes.
So is Sheetal Mataji joining? Is she here? या वो हॉस्पिटल में
है?
अच्छा अच्छा ओके हरे कृष्णा माता जी
हरे कृष्णा
ओके सो जस्ट रीड द प्रेयर्स वेरी क्विक ओम अज्ञान तिमिरं दस्य ज्ञानंजना शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपाकदामय्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम् वंदेहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतापत्नं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवंश्च श्रीरूपं सार्वजातं सहगणा रघुनाथन्वितं सुतं सजीवम् सार्ववेदं सार्वदूतं वञ्चनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् श्रीराधा कृष्णपादां सहगणा ललिता श्रीकृष्णं श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद हरे कृष्ण हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं श्री गुरु दीनाथ हरनाम हरे कृष्ण सो लेट्स डू द 15 चैप्टर सो वी कैन गेट दैट डन सो one way to do this is to read all the Sanskrit quickly and then read this there are only 20 shlokas so it's not much and this chapter is called yoga of the supreme person remember there are 18 chapters this is the 15th chapter in hindi it's called purushottam yoga so in purushottam month it's considered auspicious to read this chapter so we'll just read the Sanskrit very quick and then translations is that okay So should we, can we read it together or should we, like I say, and then follow, lead and follow? Or?
I think leading follow would be better.
Okay.
Lead and follow because I think aapka, we will be able to pronounce better once you lead us.
Okay, Prabhu. Okay. This chapter is Yoga of the Supreme Person, text one. श्री भगवान उवाच ऊर्ध्वा मूलम अधा शाखम अश्वत्थम प्राहुर अव्ययम् छन्दांसि यस्य पर्णानि यस्तं वेद स वेदवित्
यस्तं वेद स वेदवित्
नेक्स्ट अधश्चोर्ध्वं प्रशर्तस्तस्य शाखा
अधश्चोर्ध्वं प्रशर्तस्तस्य शाखा
गुणा प्रवृद्ध विषया प्रबला
प्रवृद्ध विषाय प्रबल
अदक्ष मूलान्यनु संततानि कर्मानुबंधिनी मनुष्यलोके
कर्मानुबंधिनी मनुष्यलोके
दिस इज टेक्स्ट 3 एंड 4 नारूपम अशेह ततोपलभ्यते
नारूपम असेयं तथोपलभ्यते
नान्तो न चार्दिन च संप्रतिष्ठा
नान्तो न चार्दिन स संप्रतिष्ठा
अश्वत्थाम एनम सुविरोड़ा मूलम असंगा शास्त्रेण दृढ़ेन चित्त्वा तथा पदं तत् परिमार्गितव्यम् यस्मिन् गतान् निवृत्तन्ति भूय तमेव चाद्यं पुरुषं प्रपद्ये यत्ता प्रवृत्ति प्रसृता पुराणी
यतः प्रवृत्ति प्रसृता पुराणी
निर्मानमोहजीता संगदोषा अध्यात्म नित्य विनिवृत्त कामा द्वंद्वेर विमुक्त सुखा दुखा समग्ये गच्छन्ति अमूढपदम् अव्ययम् तत् न तद्भाष्यते सूर्यो न शशांको न पावक यद्गत्वा न निवर्तन्ते तद्धाम परमं मम मामेव अंशो जीवलोके
जीवभूतसनातना
मना षष्ठानि इन्द्रियाणि प्रकृतिस्थानि कर्षति शरीरं यद् अवाप्नोति यच्चापि उत्क्रम अतिश्वरा गृहीत्वैतानि सम्याति वायुर्गन्धानि वाशयत् श्रुतं चक्षुस्पर्शानां च रसनं घ्राणमेव च अधिष्ठाय मनश्चायं विषयानुपसेवते उत्क्रमान्तं स्थितं वापि भुञ्जानं वा गुणान्वितम् विमूढानानुपश्यन्ति पश्यन्ति
ज्ञानचक्षुषा
यतन्तो योगिनाश्चैनम् पश्यन्ति आत्मनि अवस्थितम् यतन्तोऽपि अकृतात्मानो नयनं पश्यन्ति अचेतशा यद् आदित्यगतं तेजो जगद् भास्यते अखिलम् यच्चन्द्रमसि यच्चाग्नौ तत्तेजो विधिमामकम् गाम अविश्य च भूतानि धारयामि अहम् ओजस पूष्णामि चौषधि सर्वा सोमो भूत्वा रसात्मका अहम वैश्वानरो भूत्वा
अहम वैश्वानरो भूत्वा
प्राणिनां देहम आश्रिता
प्राणिनां देहम आश्रिता
प्राणपान समायुक्ता
प्राणयापन समायुक्ता
पचाम्य अन्नम चतुर्विधम सर्वस्य चाहम हृदि सन्निविष्टो मत्ता स्मृते ज्ञानम अपोहनम च वेदैश्च सर्वैर अहम् एव वेद्यो वेदांत कृत वेद विद एव च अहम्
वेदांत कृत वेद विद एव च अहम्
द्वाविमौ पुरुषौ लोके
द्वाविमौ पुरुषौ लोके
चाक्षरा
एव च
शरा सर्वाणि भूतानि कूटस्थो अक्षर उच्यते उत्तमा पुरुषस्त्व अन्या परमात्मेति उदारता यो लोकात्रयम्
अविश्य
विभर्ति अव्यया ईश्वरा यस्मात् क्षरम् अतीतो अहम् अक्षराद् अपि चोत्तमा अतो अस्मि लोके वेदे च प्रतिता पुरुषोत्तमा यो मामेवम् असमूढो जानाति पुरुषोत्तमम् स सर्वविद् भजति माम् सर्वभावेन भारत इति गुह्यतमं शास्त्रम् इदम् उक्तं मया नघ एतद् बुद्ध वा बुद्धिमान् स्यात् कृताकृत्यश्च भारत
बहुत डीप है लेकिन ये
लेट्स डिवाइड एंड रीड ट्रांसलेशन
You have to teach me the number 14. I say that every time before we eat, but I think I don't pronounce little. I think I pronounce it about 90% correct.
Yes, Prabhuji. अच्छा आप ये read करते हैं very nice.
अहम् वैष्णरो भूत्वा प्राणिनां देहमाश्रितः प्राणपान समायुक्तः पञ्चामनं चतुर्विधम्.
हाँ तो बिल्कुल ठीक बोल रहे हो.
भगवान जी अंदर बैठे हुए हैं.
Oh,
wow. Now, did you see the tube light?
Come on, brother.
Tube light came on.
We say it so wrong.
No, we don't say it so wrong.
I say
no,
it.
No. बिल्कुल ठीक बोला आपने तो. You were perfectly fine. Okay, Avinash, you want to read maybe first three?
Okay. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, it is said that there is imperishable banyan tree that has its root upward and its branches down and whose leaves are Vedic hymns. One who knows this tree is the knower of the Vedas. Text 2. The branches of this tree extend downward and upward, nourished by the three modes of material nature. The twigs are the objects of the senses. This tree also has roots going down, and these are bound to be fruitive action of human society. Text 3 and 4. The real form of this tree cannot be perceived in this world. No one can understand where it ends, where it begins, or where its foundation is. But with determination, one must cut down this strongly rooted tree with the weapon of detachment. Thereafter, one must seek that place from which, having gone, one never returns, and there surrender to that supreme personality of the Godhead, from whom everything began and from whom everything has extended since time immemorial.
Okay. Agni, do you want to read next three?
Okay. Text 5. Those who are free from false prestige, illusion, and false association, who understand the eternal, who are done with the material lust, who are freed from the dualities of happiness and distress, and who, unbewildered, know how to surrender unto the Supreme Person, attain to that eternal kingdom. Text 6. That supreme abode of mine is not illumined by the sun or moon, nor by fire or electricity. Those who reach it never return to this material world. Text 7. Text 7. The living entities in this conditioned world are my eternal fragmental parts. Due to conditioned life, they are struggling very hard with the six senses, which include the mind.
Vivek, can you read?
Text 8. The living entity in the material world carries his different conceptions of life from one body to another, as the air carries aromas. Thus he takes one kind of body and again quits it to take another. Text 9. The living entity thus taking another growth body obtains a certain type of ear, eye, tongue, nose, and sense of touch, which are grouped about the mind. He thus enjoys a particular set of sense objects. Text 10. The foolish cannot understand how a living entity can quit his body, nor can they understand what sort of body he enjoys under the spell of the modes of nature. But one whose eyes are trained in knowledge can see all of this.
Raina, can you read?
Text 11. The endeavoring transcendentalist who are situated in self-realization can see all this clearly, but those whose minds are not developed and who are not situated in self-realization cannot see what is taking place, though they may try to. Text 12. The splendor of the sun, which dissipates the darkness of this whole world, comes from me, and the splendor of the moon and the splendor of fire are also from me. Text 13. I enter into each planet, and by my energy they stay in orbit. I become the moon, and thereby supply the juice of life to all vegetables.
Muliprabhu, can you read next two?
Yeah, sure. 14. I'm the fire of digestion in the bodies of all living entities, and I join with the air of life, outgoing and incoming, to digest the four kinds of foodstuff. Text 15. I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. By all the Vedas, I am to be known. Indeed, I am the compiler of Vedanta, and I am the knower of the Vedas.
Mataji, can you read? Can't hear you. There are two classes of beings, the fallible and the infallible. In the material world, every living entity is fallible, and in the spiritual world, every living entity is called infallible. Shloka 17. Besides these two, there is the greatest living personality, the Supreme Soul, the imperishable Lord Himself, who has entered the three worlds and is maintaining them.
Ravi Prabhu, aap kar lijiye.
Shloka 18. Because I am transcendental, beyond both the fallible and the infallible, and because I am the greatest, I am celebrated both in the world and in the Vedas as the Supreme Person. Text 19. Whoever knows me as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, without doubting, is the knower of everything. He therefore engages himself in full devotional service to me, O son of Bharata. Number 20. This is the most confidential part of the Vedic scriptures. O sinless one, and it is disclosed now by me, whoever understands this will become wise, and his endeavors will know perfection.
Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport to the 15th chapter of Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of Purushottam Yoga, the Yoga of Supreme Person. Purushottam Yoga, chapter 15 ki jai. Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Okay, so we are not doing anything more with this chapter. I mean, we can read on our own. We are not there yet. But if somebody wanted to remember two or three shlokas from this, like Ravi Prabhu has memorized 14th, 15th is also very important. 15.15, Sarvasya cha amriti sannivishto. This is a very important shloka. So basically Krishna is saying that all the remembrance, forgetfulness, knowledge, everything comes from me. So, you know, when we think that, oh, I forgot something, or like Agni just had a tube-like moment, she suddenly realized. So that kind of remembrance also comes from Krishna. So at the key moment, Krishna can make you forget stuff, knowledge when you need it, or make you remember it when you need it the most, either way. So, and then another very important one is 15.7, Mameva Mamsho Jivaloke. It just tells you that all the living entities are my fragment, eternal fragmental parts, and they're suffering because of their senses and mind. So 15.7, 14 that Prabhuji has remembered, and 15 are very important.
Okay. And this sloka number 8, that explains the imprint, the spiritual bank balance. You know, when we say like what happens, you know, when you change the body, that's number 8. It is saying like how it gets transferred. Like the example is given, like even the air, when it goes through the, you know, fragrance, you know, it carries the part of fragrance wherever the air goes. So whatever in our individual soul, that living entity is, everything that we do, it is like imprinted in that. And whenever the soul leaves us, it goes to the different one, but that imprint stays with us. That's what we say, we don't know how many or how much imprints we have from so many past lives. And then accordingly, at the time of death, whatever is more prominent, that's what the new body comes. It doesn't come right away. Actually, there's a gap before you leave the body and before you gain a new body. There's some time gap. But I think depending on whatever your thought process was during that time, accordingly you get accordingly you get the whole you know, like the body. And that's why number 9 is also explaining the same thing. The living entity thus taking another gross body obtain a certain type of ear, eye, tongue, nose and sense of touch. So like whatever you think, that's what it comes to you. This is what I understand, the imprinting part on the soul, how the bank balance is, the spiritual bank balance and all.
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. So should we move on to our chapter 6 or someone wants to do anything different before? Any questions from before? We had stopped at 20th. We read the translation, but go into discussion. Next 10 shlokas or so about the same thing that we've covered. So we can go very quickly. Very quickly today if you want. So I will read this one. Can we each read one? And then we'll quickly discuss. It should be very fast today, hopefully. So text 20 to 23. In the stage of perfection called trance or samadhi, one's mind is completely restrained from material mental activities by practice of yoga. This perfection is characterized by one's ability to see the self by the pure mind and to relish and rejoice in the self. In that joy state, one is situated in boundless transcendental happiness realized through transcendental senses. Established thus, one never departs from the truth, and upon gaining this, he thinks there is no greater gain. Being situated in such a position, one is never shaken, even in the midst of greatest difficulty. This indeed is actual freedom from all miseries arising from material contact. So this is very powerful. If you, every single line here is very strong. Let's keep reading. Can everyone pick one and keep reading?
Text 24. One should engage oneself in the practice of yoga with determination and faith and not be deviated from the path. One should abandon without exception all material desires born of mental speculation and thus control all the senses on all sides by the mind.
Okay, but Avani, read number 25.
Gradually, step by step, once it becomes situated in trance by means of intelligence, sustained by full conviction. And thus, the mind should be fixed on the self alone and should think of nothing else.
Text 26. From wherever the mind wanders with an unsteady nature, one must certainly withdraw it and bring it back under the control of the soul.
Very, very true.
The yogi whose mind is fixed.
The voice is very muffled.
The yogi whose mind is fixed on me verily attains the highest perfection of transcendental happiness. Is beyond the mode of passion, he realizes his qualitative identity with the Supreme, and thus he is freed from all the reactions to past deeds.
Was that clear, Mataji?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, I think it's the mic in this computer, you know, it only picks up the person who is in front of it, not the omnidirection, it's only monodirection. So number 28, thus the self-controlled yogi constantly engaged in yoga practice becomes free from all material contamination and achieves the highest stage of perfect happiness in transcendental loving service to the Lord.
Text 29. A true yogi observes me and all beings and also sees every being in me. Indeed, the self-realized person is the same Supreme Lord everywhere.
Text 30. For one who sees me everywhere and sees everything in me, I am never lost, nor is he ever lost to me.
Avinash, can you read?
Yeah, text 31. Such a yogi who engages in the worshipful service of the super soul, knowing that I and the super soul are one, remain always in me in all circumstances. Text 32. He is perfect yogi who by comparison to his own self see the true equality of all beings in both their happiness and their distress. O Arjuna.
I think we can only do this much today. Then Arjun starts talking. So I will just read these, but we won't discuss these. But 33, 34 are very nice. So Arjun is now talking. Text 33. Arjuna said, O Madhusudan, the system of yoga which you have summarized appears impractical and unendurable to me, for the mind is restless and unsteady. 34. The mind is restless, turbulent, obstinate, and very strong. O Krishna, and to subdue it, I think, is more difficult than controlling the wind. So these are the questions posed by Arjuna, and then we'll see what Krishna will reply to him next time. But we'll backtrack and do about 10 more before then. So that shloka, if anybody wants to memorize, 6.34 is very, very important. And Moglila Prabhu says that when he was in college, and that was the first shloka he read of Bhagavad Gita. Somehow that shloka came to him. And he read it and he thought, oh, this is talking about me. My mind is stubborn, obstinate, restless, very difficult to control, like wind, harder to control than wind. Gita is talking about me. So that's how he started reading Bhagavad Gita. And there are 6-7 more shlokas he read that he sometimes quotes, that they were very resonant with me, as if they're talking, Krishna is talking about me, or Arjuna is talking about me. So that's how, you know, the power of Bhagavad Gita is. It is a lot of deep knowledge, but all of this knowledge, we can break it down and apply it practically, actually, in our daily life. So, like I was talking to Sheetal Mataji the other day, this book of Gaur Gopal Prabhu, that I think Ravi Prabhu is reading that book right now.
Yes, Life Amazing Secrets, Four Life Amazing Secrets.
Yes, so he does not talk about Bhagavad Gita, he does not talk about any Krishna consciousness, religion or Hinduism or scriptures or anything. He just talks about various experiences of his life and the story. He has woven all these experiences into one story, and he gives a very practical understanding of all these concepts, how our relationship should be, how our professional life should be, how to deal with, let's say, money, or how to meditate, and very practically he has broken it down, the whole knowledge. So
example, the life is like a four wheels of the car. So you can't just run the car on one wheel or two wheels. So it's a very good book. I finished reading it. It's nice. I want to read one more time. So all those four wheels, like you start from your personal life, relationship, then social life and spiritual life. All four of them needs to be balanced. Then only your car will ride smoothly. Otherwise, you will always have to go and get the rotation and balance. Means always will be in the distress. But yeah, that book is really good. Really yes. Good.
Yeah, he talks about the four wheels. That's very nice. So I actually have a copy for Raina also. I just have to drop it sometimes. So anyways, in text 20-23, so Krishna is basically elaborating on the practice of yoga in the next 10 shlokas. So we'll just quickly talk about this. So he's again talking about trance or samadhi. So samadhi or trance basically means fixing one's mind on something, right? In Krishna consciousness, there Prabhupada instructs us to fix mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. So that way it does not go anywhere. And if it does go somewhere, you just bring it back gently and try to keep the focus. And it takes practice. You start with, you know, short amount of time, a few minutes every day, and then you can hold the focus longer. We're able to fix our mind longer as we keep practicing. And it seems very hard. Like Arjun later on asks, but this seems impractical to me. This seems unendurable to me. This is not possible to do all this. So, if somebody does this properly, then slowly they come to the stage where they start, where this process becomes very joyful. So you are rid of all your miseries in that time. You are not connected with the world in that time. World and everything around us is a source of misery. You are turning away from the external and looking at the internal. So you are looking at the Paramatma within, which is completely joyful state. So once we can practice this meditation for long periods of time, you know, we can hold our focus, we come to that joyful state. And like, if you remember how Amoghlila Prabhu said, the soul is feasting. So body is fasting. You know, your mind is fasting because there are no thoughts running in it. Your body is fasting because you're not feeding it. Like today on Ekadashi, we are partially fasting. So the body is fasting, but the soul is feasting. The soul is joyful. And that's the process of yoga, where you're not focused on the body so much. You're not focused on the senses and the mind so much. You're focused on the soul, which is now joyful, feasting. Because the eternal position of soul is to focus on Krishna, to connect with Krishna. So when it gets to do that, it is rid of all the miseries caused by senses and mind, and then it becomes to that joyful state. So that is why Krishna says here that in that joy state, we are in boundless transcendental happiness. So transcendental basically means spiritual or something that is above the material modes, right? So that becomes transcendental or divine. So we are in that. We are rid of the material mode. We are not in mode of goodness, ignorance, or passion. We are above that stage. And so we are in transcendental happiness. It's all spiritual. So all these processes we do of eating prasadam, that's all spiritual processes. So we are above the material modes in that situation. And we convert everything to divine or transcendental. So the soul becomes aware of its constitutional position and becomes one with, you know, becomes the servant of God, realizes that I'm the servant of God. And then Krishna gives the usefulness of this process, that one is never shaken even in the midst of greatest difficulty. So everybody likes to be in that position where even when we are in greatest, turmoil of our lives, we are not overwhelmed. We are able to face those situations. And somebody who's been practicing this yoga, who's been looking at Paramatma, who's been fixing their mind on Paramatma for so many years, when the time comes of difficulties, they will be able to face the difficulties better. So he's actually free from, in such a state, he's free from miseries arising from material contact. So there is no material contact when you're in meditation. You're completely in spiritual trance, samadhi. Anybody wants to add anything?
When you said it, almost everything, but I think it's an experience also. A person doesn't have to do it for a long, long, long time. Even sincerely, one practices the meditation, no matter what type, as long as the mind is focused on one object, whether it is just your own body, your own breath, your mantra, lotus feet of Krishna, very soon, I mean, one has to be sincere. Very soon you start getting that happiness. Suddenly while chanting or while meditating, you'll have a smile on your face for no reason. So I think that's like when you are looking internally, you are basically touching the Paramatma, which is, you know, the five layers of our body. The fifth one is the Anandamaya Kosha. I mean, very hard to go there because you have to dissolve all other four layers of the gross body and the subtle body.
before you go beyond the body, which is the anandamaya, the happiness, the state of joyfulness all the time. So I think one, I mean, few days I have experienced, suddenly there will be a smile on the face while I'm chanting or while I'm meditating. So I think that's what it's talking about. I mean, the joy is not outward, it's always inward. No, don't whisper, tell. Everybody will listen to your question, they'll answer. Pull. Yeah, 5 minutes.
Your question is answered, Vade? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Prabhuji. So yeah, you're right. We just, even for a short period of time, if you can focus your mind, you experience this blissful state and you come to realize your true nature, which is not this body, which is not this material nature.
And then you make progress because you begin to realize that, okay, just by sitting and just by chanting, I'm getting blissful, I'm getting joy. So then the journey starts. Then you get, oh, let's do more, more and more. And then it gives you that peace and obviously the happiness together. But yes, one has to start the karma, the process, then you start enjoying the process of meditation.
Yes, so 24 also Krishna is stressing on the fact that yoga, practice of yoga will ultimately lead to success. Success is what? Success here means what? That we will be able to realize Paramatma, right? We'll be able to reach that transcendental blissful state. That success will be free from material.
One word answer. When you ask success is what is, she said liberation.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, liberation. And liberation means freedom. Freedom, right? Freedom from what? Freedom from the body. Freedom from the pains caused by the body. The miseries caused by the body or the material nature. So you will be able to reach that success. And we should know that yoga will lead us to. So when we do something, let's say when you study really hard for an exam, you know that if you study really hard, you will get A plus grade or 100% marks or something, right? You have that faith that if I know my topic really well, I will be able to succeed in this exam. Similarly, the problem with yoga is that most of the people do not have faith in the system. They don't believe that this is possible. So the first thing is to have some faith. Know that Krishna has promised here in Bhagavad Gita. Krishna has made many, many promises in Bhagavad Gita, but those promises are for people that are following the path. So a lot of people will, you know, say that, oh, Krishna is not coming to the earth. He's not fulfilling his promise. He said that whenever there is a dharma, he will come. He's not coming. But then that promise was for his devotees. He comes to give association to devotees, to people that follow his instructions. Nobody's following his instruction. Forget following. I mean, application is hard, but nobody's even attempting. Nobody's even reading Bhagavad Gita. So why would he come? So liberation or this is not possible unless we have faith. So Krishna has given us this instruction. We just need to follow that path. So he's saying in text 24 that you need to have the faith that this process will bring you success. And then with determination, you go on this path. So determination doesn't come because we don't believe in it. So we need to believe that it will happen, that liberation will happen, that happiness will come, even happiness or liberation in this material body will come, that we will experience that joyous state. We will be able to see the inner Paramatma. All of this, if we have faith in, then we can do the yoga better. So he says to do the yoga with determination and faith and not be deviated from the path, he's saying. And control all the senses and mind. So do not do mental speculation. He's giving the process. So he's saying, do not use your own, do not use your mental speculative process. Do not be distracted by the material desires. Do not be distracted by the senses and the mind. Abandon them. So he's saying one should abandon all material desires. So abandon those desires, those distractions caused by the senses and mind, and just practice this path. So this is a very, very clear instruction.
And I think that is always, you know, like people deviate from the path because there is they always think, okay, this is not working for me. Let me do this. That is why it is always, you know, if you see, they always gave, okay, this is the only one path. It doesn't mean that there's no other path, but if you are not determined, this is the only path I'm going to take. It is not that if I have to reach Memphis, I will drive 10 miles to the west and then come back and 15 miles to the east. I will never reach Memphis. Once you choose the path, you have to keep on going. Obviously, you might just take time to choose one path, but once the path is chosen, then determination has to be there, and the faith. Faith is very important. And then rest of the journey will be taken care. I think that is why I said don't deviate from the path. Once you choose the path, stay on it.
Yes, Prabhuji. Anybody else wants to add? Any of the kids? Murli Prabhu, Sheetal, Mataji? Okay. So we'll keep moving because I think we can finish a few. So then Krishna says in 25th that if you keep on this path, I know that he's saying it's hard, but you keep on this with faith and determination. Try to fix your mind in trance by means of intelligence. So use the intelligence that this will work, and then stay in trance or fix your mind and think of nothing else. He says, na kinchidapi chintayet. Shloka says, na kinchidapi chintayet, meaning do not think of anything else. Just focus your mind, fix your mind on me, and step by step, gradually you will make progress. So it seems like it's taking forever, but gradually the progress will come. We will be able to fix our mind better. We will be able to control our senses and mind much more if we keep on practicing. And in the purport, Prabhupada says cessation of sense activities and cessation of mind is very important. So controlling the body basically means, so we don't want our body to take over. We want our soul to enjoy. If we let the body take over, body basically means senses and mind, right? If we let that take over, then there will be a whole lot of desires, distractions, problems, engagements of the body. Everything will take over. And then it's not possible to control anything. Then you cannot fix your mind on Paramatma. So he says, practice pratyahara. Pratyahara means cessation of sense activities. So disengage yourself from various sense activities. And atyahara means when people are in, you know, nowadays in the practice of atyahara, meaning everything is too much. They're listening too much, hearing too much, speaking too much, watching too much, eating too much. Everything is atyahara. So from that stage, come to pratyahara, where you're actually controlling yourself and finally stopping those things when you're practicing dhyana yoga. So otherwise, dhyana yoga is not possible if we are so much distracted by all these senses. The senses are so used to working extra all the time that when we stop them, it's very hard. People find it very hard to stop them. So that's what Krishna is saying in 25.
What is also gradually, is like it will happen gradually. Like, I mean, I don't know if Murli Prabhu, you may not have heard this. There was one Kabir ka sloka in Hindi, Karat Karat Abhyaste Jarmati Hot Sujan and Rasri Parat. Like, it's the English is basically, if you keep practicing, even the idiot or the foolishest will basically gain knowledge. It's like on the well, the rope, it keeps going up and down to get the water. Even on the stone, there is a mark of the rope just by having, you know, like by pulling the bucket, you know. You see what I'm saying?
So even the rope mark can be come on the stone. So it's, we are just a human. If we keep practicing, there is no way that outcome is not going to come. So that gradually we have to, we can't just expect overnight or over week, over month, over, why we are not having the happiness? Why we are not able to seize our senses? But we have to be gradual, sincerely and gradually.
And that's why people quit, because they think, okay, we are not seeing any results, but result is happening. It's remember, it's our subtle body we are trying to work on. So the results are also subtle. Even when you work on your gross body, let's say somebody's trying to lose weight, let's say somebody's trying to gain knowledge, even that process seems so slow. Like losing weight or building your body, you have to work in the gym every day for so many months to make six packs. So this is subtle. We are working on our subtle body. This is even harder to control, harder to transform. So that's why the changes also happen very slowly. But they do happen, and that's why Krishna is saying to just keep on the path. 26 also, he, again, we have talked about this many times, that the mind will wander because of its flickering and unsteady nature. So in the shloka, Krishna has used the word chanchalam asthiram, manas chanchalam asthiram, meaning man is chanchal and asthir. Asthir means that it's not steady, and chanchal means it's flickering, like naughty. So mind is very flickering and unsteady, and so it will wander. But we have to bring it back under the control of the self. So self meaning soul here, right? Our spirit soul is our true self. So keep it under the control of the soul. Don't let it get deviated by the external problems and senses and all this. So mind will wander, but you bring it back. And then in the Parapat, Prabhupada uses some words that there is somebody who's called a Goswami, right? We say that, like in Krishna consciousness, in ISKCON, there are six Shad Goswami that are very famous. So Goswami is basically somebody who's controller of senses and mind, who has controlled their senses and mind. They're the Swami means controller or master. So somebody who has controlled their senses and mind is Goswami. Whereas somebody who's a servant of senses and mind is Godas. So we don't want to be Godas. We want to be controller. We want to be the master of our body, not be a servant of the body. So Goswami and Godas, is that's what it means. But the reason a Goswami becomes a Goswami is because they know that the pleasure you get with dhyan, or with connecting to Krishna, with connecting to Paramatma, the internal pleasure that you get is so much higher compared to the material sense pleasures. Even if you fulfill your material desires, they cannot compete with the spiritual pleasures at all. So that's why they are able to stay fixed on their path, because they have experienced, they have got in touch with the Paramatma. They have experienced that joy, that bliss. And now it's very they do not want to come down to the platform of material desires, because that's nothing. So in some of the lectures, it is said that it's like a pig enjoys the stools, right? We cannot even imagine that. Whereas pig is enjoying it. You cannot even imagine it. Similarly, a Goswami has come to that platform where when they see us enjoying these material pleasures, they cannot even imagine how these people are enjoying these small transient material pleasures when they could be enjoying this transcendental bliss. So that's the platform they are at. And that's where we are trying to improve our taste. If we are so used to these smaller, lower tastes, that higher taste is inconceivable to us. So we cannot even imagine what that higher taste would feel like. So we have to go to that place where the material sense pleasure is no longer appealing. Does that make sense?
Yes, Master.
So Goswamis, basically they are using all their body, their mind, their senses in the service of Krishna. And Prabhupada describes that as Krishna consciousness. So he has given that his philosophy, the word Krishna consciousness, where you engage your body, your everything in the service of Krishna. And in this way, you purify your senses, you purify your mind slowly. So by reading of the scriptures, you purify your mind by bhajan kirtan or chanting, or by eating prasadam, you purify your senses. By association of devotees, you purify your senses. So that process where you purify your senses and mind, he's called it Krishna consciousness. So since we are so fallen, it is not easy for us to go to that Goswami platform. He gives this process of purification. And once our senses are purified, then we can serve Krishna. We can do all our karma. Then our karmas become karma yoga or a karma. Everything becomes transcendental in our life. Our relationships, our professions, everything transforms. So that's something is mentioned in the purport in detail. So, and another thing he mentions is that I really liked, that if you practice self-control, then you can achieve self-realization. So understanding your true self, that we are the soul and we have to serve Krishna, and Krishna is our goal, that self-realization is only possible with self-control. So if we are not controlled at all, if our body is controlling us, if we are Godas, we are controlled by our body, then it's very difficult to achieve self-realization. Because then you think, I am this body. Then you think, I am the master. Then you think, I am the enjoyer. I am the owner. Whereas if you practice self-control, you can see Krishna, Paramatma inside you. And then you understand that you are not the body, you are not the owner, you are not the controller, you are not the enjoyer or anything. You are just a servant of Krishna. So that self-realization is only possible with self-control. So self-control is the first step. Okay, please add anything, if any thoughts.
Mataji, I think we're good.
So, okay. 27 also same thing. 27, I really like the shloka very much. So in this one, if you read the Sanskrit, Krishna has mentioned a few words, like I'll open it very quickly here. So he again, like last time we discussed these shlokas, he again talks about the goal that we have to reach with this Dhyan Yoga. So he says, Prasannata Manasam. So mind becomes happy. Prasan or peaceful. Okay, mind becomes prashant or peaceful. Prasan. Sukham Uttamam. Uttam Sukham, meaning the highest joy comes. Shanta Rajasam. Shanti, you mean no, means peace, right? Shanti means peace. Rajasam is Rajogun. So mode of passion becomes shant, or mode of passion becomes subdued. So it is actually, you know, most of us are not so much in mode of ignorance. We are actually more in mode of passion all the time, right? So mode of passion becomes very shant, very quiet. Brahma Bhutam means, this is what Ravi Prabhu was talking about. When you touch, when you come in contact with Paramatma, so you identify the Paramatma inside, you reach that layer inside, the layer that Ravi Prabhu was talking about, the innermost. If this is a concentric circle, the innermost circle, the fifth circle inside is where Super Soul, Paramatma is. That achieving that layer, touching that layer is Brahma Bhutam. So when you're on that platform. A Kalmasham. Kalmasham always means sin in Sanskrit. So A Kalmasham means that your sinful reactions are gone. So you're freed from sinful reactions. So this whole shloka actually tells you what all will happen. So your mind becomes peaceful. You will enjoy the highest happiness. Your mode of passion will become quiet. We will achieve the platform of Paramatma. And we will be freed from our sinful reactions. So I really like this because Krishna clearly says that by fixing your mind on me, you will achieve all these. Just like in one of the previous shlokas last time he said. So again, he's reinforcing to us that what all can happen. So just wanted to share that. So the people that are, you know, that have been successful in the on this path, like for example, if you take Krishna consciousness, people that have been in Krishna consciousness for a long time, they understand this goal. And they know that material disease is very, very distracting. It is very, very powerful. Maya is very, very powerful. And they know the goal is to free yourself from material disease, to free yourself from mode of passion. So that's why as much as possible, they stay in mode of goodness. They decrease their engagements so that they are not afflicted by this material disease so much. So that is one way of, one process to remain in Krishna consciousness. Yes, everybody is okay with this?
Yes, not Avni, all good.
Avni looks sleepy.
Yeah, other Mataji was sleeping, so I just sent her to sleep.
Oh, really?
Oh, but he was really dozing off today. I don't know why. She also, they are fasting, so they ate just before the session. So they ate around 3 o'clock. I guess the carb got her.
Okay, why don't we, so 28 and 29, I'll just quickly tell you, it's same thing. Again, Krishna is saying, reinforcing in that 28, atyantam sukham ashnute, meaning atyant suk, meaning a lot of happiness happens. Brahma samparsham, Brahma, again, like Ravi Prabhu was saying, you can touch some sparsh means to contact, to touch. So Brahma samparsham means that you can touch the Krishna or Paramatma inside you. So that is the highest stage of perfection. And 29, Krishna says that true yogi sees Paramatma in everyone and sees everyone in Paramatma, meaning that Paramatma is within everyone and everyone is situated in Krishna. So what does that mean? We know that Paramatma is in everyone. What does it mean that everyone is situated in Krishna? Does anyone know? Avni, you want to?
Did you get the question?
Can you repeat that?
So Krishna says a true yogi knows that Paramatma is situated in everyone, right? We know that we have super soul within us. Mm-hmm. He also knows that everyone is situated in Krishna. What does that mean? How is everybody situated in Krishna? What did she say?
Everybody is a part of Krishna.
Yes. Everybody, everything is a part of Krishna, right? So we are, for example, we are situated in this space, in this material space. That material energy is also energy of Krishna, right? So we are within this body. The body is also property of Krishna. So we are situated in Krishna and Krishna is situated in us. So true yogi knows that. And that's why we remember that shloka. Who remembers that shloka from fifth chapter? Who can recite it? Equanimity.
Navya Mataji can recite.
Navya Mataji is doing something. I think I thought Vaidehi or Avni knew that one. Vidya Vinay Sampanne.
Vidya Vinay Sampanne. I don't think they
know. So that shloka was about equanimity. How a true yogi sees treats everybody equally, right? He treats a dog, a Brahman.
Brahman, dog eater,
cow, elephant, dog eater, everybody seen. So that was 5.18. So anyway, so that's, again, they're saying the same point here, that true yogi treats people equally because he knows that Krishna is situated in everyone's heart. And so, and Krishna is neutral to everyone, right? Krishna, this is a little bit of a difficult concept to understand because we think that Krishna is favoring his devotees. Like Arjuna, Krishna is always favoring his devotee. But here it says Krishna is neutral to everyone. So there is a lot of discussion on this in Bhagavatam. But ultimately the point is that Krishna is neutral to everyone. it appears that he's favoring devotees more because he comes towards you as much as you go towards him. So if you're taking steps to reach him, he will also meet you. He will also come that much further into your life. So it looks like he's treating the devotees favorably, but he's just neutral. He's just responding, reciprocating to people accordingly. So let's say a teacher gives 100 marks to somebody and 50 to another student. Does that mean the teacher is treating those two students differently?
No.
No, right? Because one student did well, he answered all the questions, so she has no choice but to give him 100% marks. The other one answered 50%, so she had to give him 50% marks. So it's not that she's neutral to everyone, but she has a duty to respond to each student according to their work, according to their responses. So she's reciprocating to them as much as they put in their work. So the more work somebody put in, the more she has to give marks. So similarly with Krishna, it looks like he's favoring his devotees more, but the devotees are also praying to Krishna more, focusing on Krishna more, taking steps to realize him. So, but he is otherwise neutral. So that was 29. 30th, I think we can read. 30th is very, very nice. Somebody can, who's falling asleep the most?
Now, nobody. I think the one who was falling went, but we'll need a charger.
Okay. I think Raina will read, because I can't see her in the screen.
Oh, I'm right here.
Yeah, I'll just read the Sanskrit very quick, because this is an important shloka. Yo mam pashyati sarvatra.
Yo mam pashyati sarvatra.
Sarvam cha mai pashyati.
Sarvam cha mai pashyati.
Chati.
Tasyaham na pranashyami.
Tasyaham na pranashyami.
Sacha mena pranashyati.
Sacha mena pranashyati.
So it means yo mam pashyati sarvatra. Whoever sees me everywhere. Sarvam cha mai pashyati. Who sees me in everything. Tasyaham na pranashyami. I keep him in my sight too. Sa cha me na pranashyati. And he's never lost to me. So if you have your eyes on Krishna, then Krishna will keep his eyes on you, right? Krishna will keep you in his sight and then he will take care of you. But if you're not looking for him, if you do not have eyes on him, then he's not keeping an eye on you either. So he clearly says here this concept. So, okay, Raina, do you want to read?
For one who sees me every... Oh, I'm supposed to read the purport?
Yeah.
No, go ahead.
For one who sees me everywhere and sees everything in me, I am never lost, nor is he ever lost to me. A person in Krishna consciousness certainly sees Lord Krishna everywhere, and he sees everything in Krishna. Such a person may appear to see all separate manifestations of the material nature, but in each and every instance he is conscious of Krishna. Knowing that everything is a manifestation of Krishna's energy, nothing can exist without Krishna, and Krishna is the Lord of everything. This is the basic principle of Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness is the development of love of Krishna, a position transcendental even to material liberation. At this stage of Krishna consciousness, beyond self-realization, the devotee becomes one with Krishna in the sense that Krishna becomes everything for the devotee, and the devotee becomes full in love in Krishna. An intimate relationship between the Lord and the devotee then exists. In that stage, the living entity can never be annihilated, nor is the personality of Godhead ever out of the sight of the devotee. To merge in Krishna is spiritual annihilation. A devotee takes no such risk as stated in the Brahma Samhita 5.38.
I can read this very quick, Rani. Premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena santa sadeva hridayeshu vilokayanti यम श्याम सुंदरम अचिंतया गुणास्वरूपम गोविंदमादि पुरुषम तमहं भजामि.
I worship the Primeval Lord Govinda, who is always seen by the devotee, whose eyes are anointed with the pulp of love. He is seen in his eternal form of
Samaya Sundara.
Samaya Sundara.
Swayam
Sundara.
Shyam Sundara.
Shyam Sundara, situated within the heart of the devotee. At this stage, Lord Krishna never disappears from the sight of the devotee, nor does the devotee ever lose sight of the Lord. In the case of a yogi who sees the Lord as Paramatma within the heart, the same applies. Such a yogi turns into a pure devotee and cannot bear to live for a moment without seeing the Lord within himself.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Dana, you want to share anything?
I think you explain everything the best, so I'll leave that to you.
Okay. So in the first paragraph, Prabhupada is basically talking about Krishna consciousness process, where a devotee is completely, he sees Krishna in everything like we talked about, and everything is a manifestation of Krishna's energy, right? So he knows that if somebody does something good or bad, that is also coming from the three modes of material energy, which is basically Krishna's energy. Time is also Krishna's energy, and it will come later on, but Kal or time factor is basically Krishna's energy. So when something wrong is going on, you know that this time will pass. This is just a matter of time, and so this is will of Krishna. It is his energy again. So in everything, basically, he sees Krishna. If there are good qualities in somebody, that is coming from Krishna. If there are bad qualities in somebody, they are the perverted reflection of Krishna's good qualities. So everything is basically, he's a Krishna conscious person is like that. And then this Brahma Samhita shloka is very nice. I had pulled it up here. That a devotee sees Krishna with eyes anointed with love, meaning eyes of devotion. So he, that's why he's able to treat everyone with pure, love and compassion, because he has so much love for Krishna that he cannot treat people badly, because those are all part and parcels of Krishna. So that concept is mentioned here. And then in the end, Prabhupada ends with the same thing as was mentioned in the translation, that if you keep Krishna in view, then Krishna will also keep a sight on you, and he'll be watching you. So just like once what happened was maybe Nirbhay Prabhu remembers the story better, but somebody asked Vishnuji, everybody is meditating upon you. Who are you meditating upon? Because he's always in this trance. Like you see Vishnu, he has eyes closed and he's not sleeping. He's in yog nidra, meaning he's in this sleep. Which is spiritual, which is divine. So who are you focusing on? Who are you thinking about? So what did he answer? Who was he thinking about?
Deities.
Yeah, yes, Prabhu. Please answer loudly.
Yeah, whoever he is thinking of, Krishna, he is thinking of them.
Yeah, so he's thinking of his devotees. So people are meditating on him and he's meditating on them. Right. So he's keeping eye on them. So that's, I wanted to share about that. 31 talks about super soul. We already know about that concept. Super soul. Raina, will you tell what is super soul?
Isn't that Krishna?
Yeah. Paramatma is super soul.
Mm-hmm. The part of Krishna that is in you.
Yes. Yeah. So it's his all pervasive aspect, right? That is entering into everybody. That's Paramatma, which is within us. So Prabhuji, we were just discussing this one, but you already heard it. So we were talking about how somebody asked Vishnu once, who do you meditate upon? Like everybody's meditating upon you. You are the Supreme Person. So who are you meditating upon? So Murli Prabhu answered, that he is meditating upon his devotees. So people are meditating upon him and he is meditating upon them.
Yes. Okay.
So here
in
In this shloka, he clearly says that I keep everyone in my sight. Whoever looks at me, I look at them.
Okay. Sorry, because my computer went dead, so that's how we logged out. But now we are okay.
His HP.
And then 31, I was saying 31 just talks about super soul. Rana answered correctly that super soul is basically the Paramatma feature of Bhagavan, which is all pervasive and within everybody. So a yogi always turns inwards to look at Paramatma. 32 also, I think we should read. I will let maybe Avinash can read it. I'll pull it up here. I think we'll just read the translation. Go ahead.
He is a perfect yogi who, by comparison to his own self, see the true equality of all beings in both their happiness and their distress, O Arjuna. One who is Krishna conscious is a perfect yogi. He is aware of everyone's happiness and distress by the dint of his own personal experience. The cause of the distress of a living entity is forgetfulness of his relationship with God. And the cause of happiness is knowing Krishna to be the supreme enjoyer of all activities of the human being, the proprietor of the all lands and planet, and the sincerest friend of all living entities. The perfect yogi knows that the living being who is conditioned by the modes of material nature is subjected to the threefold material miseries due to the forgetfulness of his relationship with Krishna. And because one is Krishna consciousness is happy, he tries to distribute the knowledge of Krishna everywhere. Since the perfect yogi tries to broadcast the importance of becoming Krishna conscious, he is the best philanthropist in the world and he is the dearest servitor of the Lord. Nacha tasmam manu yeshu kanchim mi priya kritama. 18.69. In other words, a devotee of the Lord always looks to the welfare of all living entities, and in this way he is factually the friend of everyone. He is the best yogi because he doesn't desire perfection in yoga for his personal benefit, but tries for others also. He does not envy his fellow living entities. Here is a contrast between a pure devotee of the Lord and a yogi interested only in the personal elevation. The yogi who has withdrawn to a secluded place in order to meditate perfectly may not be as perfect as devotee who is trying his best to turn every man towards Krishna consciousness.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
So, I had a video, just like always. You want to watch it?
Yes, Mataji.
It's only 4 minutes and it is related to this this particular purport. So there are two concepts here. One is Krishna consciousness that Prabhupada has been mentioning throughout. But one thing is how this is a little bit, debatable. So like somebody might say, why is Prabhupada saying that the best person is who will teach others Krishna consciousness? The other concept is that Krishna consciousness is a process where you don't just do, where you don't practice yoga in isolation. You take people with you. So you teach, you spread, you associate. It's you do bhajan, kirtan, association of devotees, chanting in congregation. So it is not a secluded process. Whereas Krishna is instructing that a yogi should practice yoga in seclusion, go to the jungle, all this. So yes, both those processes are good. And actually, like you've read Prabhuji, that Gaur Gopal Prabhu's book, you have to help yourself before helping others, right? Mm-hmm. So that's one thing. So we cannot teach others what we do not practice. We have to implement these things in our own life when we start teaching or spreading the message. So that's important to help yourself. So to practice yoga on your own. But once you see the bliss, the joy it brings, the difference is that the Krishna conscious person also wants to spread the message of Krishna to everybody. So you are practicing yoga on your own. You are elevating yourself, because without elevating yourself, you cannot elevate others. But at the same time, you're also spreading the message to others. So others can also, because we know that the human life is very short. Human life is very unique, very difficult to get. So we don't want other people to miss out on the opportunity not practice. It's possible that we are taking a very long time in reaching success, but maybe if we teach other people, they can reach success. So a Krishna conscious person is not envious. He will start spreading the message so other people can also utilize their human life to the fullest. So they can also get the message of Krishna and not be left out. So that's a balance, basically. So we are not saying just do everything in seclusion, because especially nowadays, it's very hard to practice things in seclusion. So if we have more association, it's easy to inspire each other, encourage each other, glorify, and easy to progress. So you have to do your own personal bhajan, personal chanting, japa and everything, but you also have to do it in association to inspire each other and learn from each other. So that's something I wanted to mention here.
And also like yoga itself is a process of inclusiveness. It cannot be seclusive. It has to be inclusive. So as you just said, obviously one has to work on their own, because people will not listen and lecture that you give. They will see what you do. So if you are practicing one thing and preaching other thing, then it's like, okay. It becomes dhongi in the Hindi. I don't know what's called in the English. But yeah, as you said, it's a process of inclusiveness. You have to include you and everybody else. And that's how I think the yogi will start looking. Everybody is just part of himself and part of the Paramatma. So it should come, right? Once the yogi is at that stage, it will start including everybody. My guess, my little logic guess is that.
Yes, Prabhuji, no, you're very right. So that technique is called Nirjan Bhajan, where person completely separates himself, isolates himself.
Uh-huh.
And that is practiced by people at a very late stage, like when they have become sannyasis and towards the end of their life, last few years. They have mastered their senses, mind, have spread the message throughout their lives. And then towards the very last few years of their life, they just want to connect with God and do nothing else. So then they practice Nirjan Bhajan. But rest of the life, it is recommended to be in association and encourage each other and move together.
Yes. Sankirtan, right?
Yes, please. I'll share this video very quick. This talks more about Krishna consciousness.
So, why is Krishna...
Can you hear?
Yes.
Krishna consciousness, the highest consciousness. To answer this, let's hear a short story. There was a big multimillionaire who took his son to a fun fair or to an exhibition. Because of the crowd and because of the rush around, the son lost track of where the father is, the father lost track where the son is, and they got separated. The father was looking for the son starts crying for the father, and in this attempt to find each other, there happened to be many people who observed the crying child. The first person came to the child and said, "Oh, probably he's crying because he's very hungry. He might be very thirsty." So he went into a shop and got him a nice sandwich and a nice orange juice. So the child looked at it, but the child continued to cry. The second person came, looked at the child and said, "Oh, maybe the child is feeling too hot or too cold. So let me make him a little comfortable," and gave him the suitable clothes. So the child looked at the clothes, but continued to cry. The third person came in and said, "Oh, maybe the child has some stomach problem. I should give him some medicines," and gotten some medicines and offered to the child. The child looked at the medicines, but guess what? Continued to cry. Finally, the fourth person came in, looked at the child, observed him closely and said, "Hey, wait a minute. You are this multimillionaire son, isn't it? I know where your father is. I just saw him. I can take you to him." And the child, who had continued to cry for such a long time, heard this and had a big smile on his face. Now there's a question for all of you. Which among these four were the best? The person who came and gave him food, or the person who gave him some clothes, or the third person who came and gave some medicines, or the fourth person who agreed to take him to the father? Obviously the fourth one. For the reason that the child was actually crying, not because of the first three, but because he was disconnected from the father. And also for the fact that if he gets back to his father, all these first three needs are satisfied to the fullest extent. So taking that anecdote or that example in practical life, all of us are like lost children in this fun fair called as the material world, where our eternal father Shri Krishna continues to search for us. But because we are so egoistic and so stubborn in our own endeavor, we don't even make an attempt to search for him, because of which we are sad. Then we meet, by the good fortune of all the Vaishnavas, we meet devotees in our life who agree, like the fourth person, to reconnect us back to our father, that is Shri Krishna. And this process of reconnecting the souls of this world to their eternal father through the welfare activity of preaching or Krishna consciousness is the highest consciousness. Because like in this example, the fourth person connected the lost child to the searching father. Similarly, the devotees in the Krishna consciousness movement attempt to reconnect all of us, bewildered and lost sons of the same spiritual father, back to Shri Krishna through the instructions of the Bhagavad Gita, through the message of the scriptures, and through the loud chanting of the holy names. So therefore, in simple terms, we understand that by reconnecting back to Shri Krishna's service, who is our eternal father, through the process of Krishna consciousness, we get the maximum benefit, and therefore, this is the highest consciousness or the highest welfare activity possible. Hare Krishna. So continuing our discussion on...
Okay. Did everyone understand the story?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Is Abhi saying something?
Mm-mm.
So that story is very popularly quoted because you think that you will just give somebody, that child, medicine. He may be relieved of his problem for just a short while, right? You give him clothes, he'll be happy for a few minutes. You give him food, he'll be happy for a few minutes. But if you just took him back to his father, he would have provided for all of that. So connecting back to the father would relieve those problems. So it's not bad to give anybody clothes or food or medicine. It's good. It's good. You're doing something good. But it's just not permanent. So all those are transient reliefs. So all that the soul needs is to connect back to Krishna.
Mm-hmm.
So that was mentioned in the shloka that Avinash read, 6.32. That's why I want to share that. And this one is a very famous shloka in 18.69. Nacha tasman manusheshu kaschin me priya krittam. We say that if you spread my message, there is nobody else that's more
favorite to me than that person. So we have to start reading Bhagavad Gita ourselves and start spreading the message of Bhagavad Gita to others also. So we can only spread the message if we read it ourselves, if we imbibe and start practicing it ourselves. So discuss it, read it, break it down, apply it practically, and then teach others. So that's what I wanted to talk about in this one.
Avni will ask you a question maybe later. How can she teach her friends who are here? Because they teach her about, they ask you about question about Christ and all that, right?
Mm-mm.
No, not anymore?
Yeah. They never did.
They never did. Didn't they? Okay. But maybe Natasha Mataji will teach you if you want to spread the word of Gita among your friends. Without even mentioning Krishna and Gita, you can spread. God Gopal Das Parvoji book, you have to read.
Yes. Yeah, you don't have to, we're not trying to convert anybody. We're just spreading the message. For example, the message of equanimity, like treating people equally, or yes, the fact that there is only one God. You call him Christ, we call him by a different name. We call him Krishna. And God resides within all of us. So we've been given this body that may look different. You know, we have different color, different, we come in different shapes and sizes and forms and different hair and eyes and whatnot. But that is completely irrelevant. Those bodies are assigned to us based on our previous activities, our previous actions and desires. So we have to just look at the God within everybody and treat everybody equal. So that is just one of the many, many concepts. And one day we can actually, if you guys are okay, one day we can discuss the practical concepts we have learned so far from Bhagavad Gita. I mean, we should actually be able to list like 10 different things we have learned that you don't need to mention Hinduism. You don't need to even mention Krishna, like Prabhu was saying. You can just teach the practical concepts like dealing with difficulties or dualities, right? When difficulties will come, that is the nature of this world, that difficulties will come. And they come in cycles, right? Good time, bad time, good time, bad time. So good time, nobody cares. But bad time, how to deal with it? And how do we develop this tolerance to go through that difficult times? So all these things are mentioned there. We should think about them. We have to actively think about them. And there are many, many concepts that have already been covered actually in these first six chapters. We can discuss them one day.
Yeah, because once we finish the six chapters, almost everything as a part of knowledge is here. From seventh onward, it's a little bit more knowledge, but then it starts more, actually, you know, more practical and more devotion thing.
Right. Yeah, so we should all come up with at least one point each and then talk about it for a few minutes on what we can share with people, or not even share with people, what we have learned ourselves. And I think there are many, many concepts. There are at least 15 to 20 different concepts that have been covered.
We have to start actively thinking about this.
Yes.
Okay, Mataji. Now we are chanting.
Yes.
But yeah, everybody knows today is Ekadashi, right? I know Natasha Mataji knows.
Yes, Prabhu. Avinash, do you do anything for Ekadashi?
No, not right now.
What about you, Murli Prabhu? Do you do?
I think the first step for Ekadashi, at least since we are in association, I would say the grains, at least the rice part, we should not consume the rice on this day. I don't know how practical it is for everyone, especially the South origination.
It's not a butter. We can stop for one day or a couple of days. It's not a big deal.
It's actually every 2 weeks, like 11th day before the full moon, 11th day before the new moon. That should be the first step, I would say, the stopping it, stop the eating of grains.
Yeah.
And then also another practical view for people who are still chanting on a daily basis, at least do at least some more of chanting on Ekadashi.
An extra one.
Yes, Prabhu.
We'll ask Natasha Mataji. Today, Avani Mataji, this is her sixth round. She just said it's a lot of chanting. Is it a lot of chanting, Natasha Mata? Tell her. You only tell her.
I mean, depends if you've been doing, four or five rounds before, right?
Yeah, we started the five rounds in this Purushottam month.
We did.
I mean, at least I'm doing. I think you did today.
I did yesterday too.
But this is not too much, okay?
It can seem like it, but again, the point is if you focus on the words, it becomes very joyful. So it seems boring, or when the mind is involved, it becomes like if you're thinking about other things, you want to get back to other things, and it is boring.
See, that's a very good answer. It can be very joyful if you just think on Krishna and say his name with love.
Listen to each and every word. So then it will be, then you will, all the problems will fall away. You will just be focused on that. And it's very, then it becomes nice. You will see the change. Like if you keep doing and you're focusing on the words, you will see the change in yourself. You will see, suddenly it doesn't seem like too many rounds at all. You will keep chanting and it wouldn't seem much.
I don't know if she has experience or not, but I have experience. Like sometimes the first round seems like it took long time. But by the time I reach the fifth one, it's like, oh, I just started the fifth, just got finished. So because if you have experienced that, okay. Because you're completely into the name of Krishna. But we have a good chanting session in the morning. We chant together, mostly in kind of close to the Brahman Muhurt.
So, and Raina is still chanting too?
Yes. Yes. Shanti.
How many rounds are you doing?
Still one.
One, okay.
Yeah, she's doing every day.
Every day.
Yeah.
Are you going to start too, Murli Prabhu?
I've been trying to get him to start, but...
Yeah, I do a different set of prayers, Manat Mataji, but I will try for Krishna also.
Yeah.
I do other stotras and all, but not chanting just like Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, but.
Yeah. Yeah, or any kind of meditation.
Yes. Oh, yeah, I do that.
And how about Avinash?
One round every day in the morning.
Acha, very good. Very nice. Okay, let's do
nicely.
I think we all have everybody has the seed which is already sprouted. Now it depends on us whether we want to let it grow like a big banyan tree or leave it like a small plant.
Okay.
All right.
That's very nice for you. Let's start. Namo Om Vishnu Padaya.
Krishna Krishna
Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Krishna Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, 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 H